My name is Elena Suleimani. I work at the Alaska Earthquake Center at the Geophysical Institute. The program is called Tsunami Inundation Mapping for Alaska Coastal Communities. And the partners in this program are State of Alaska Division of Homeland Security and Emergency Management, and State of Alaska Division of Geological and Geophysical Surveys. On that slide, I have two photos. One of them is Valdez waterfront in 1964, and on the second one is the Ishinomaki city in Japan in 2011. Tsunamis will be happening for a long time, and they have been happening for a long time. And the natural disasters don't know how technologically advanced we are. So that's why the most important thing is to get prepared. So this map shows the coast of Alaska with the rupture zones of the major earthquakes. Each gray area represents an earthquake in the last century, and each of them generated a trans-Pacific tsunami. Each of those tsunamis went as far away as Antarctica. The red dots on this map are the coastal communities in Alaska, and you can see that all of them are located very close to those rupture areas, which means that we are pretty much sitting on top of the hazard. And this is how the tsunami hazard is defined in Alaska. We call it near field. First of all, it's because we are so close to the rupture areas. And second of all, that we have glacial fjords in Alaska. And glacial fjords is the environment where unstable sediment sits on the steep underwater slopes. And when there is ground shaking, it collapses. This movement of the sediment generates a wave, and that's why that combination of seismically active zone and glacial fjords makes it so hazardous to be in coastal Alaska in terms of tsunamis. So let's talk about several events that happened in the past. So first of all, the 1946 earthquake that happened in the Aleutian Islands generated a tsunami wave that traveled for 5.5 hours silently and killed 159 people in Hilo Harbor in Hawaii. Back then, the tsunami warning system didn't exist in the United States. That's why people in Hilo, when they saw the water going away, they just went to the harbor and see what's happening, and to see what's the exposed on the ocean floor. And little they knew, right? So they were killed in less than 15 minutes after that. There was no way to escape that wave. Then the 1964 earthquake generated huge waves, and 92 fatalities of all who died in that earthquake actually died from tsunamis. But what's interesting, from all the fatalities in tsunamis, there were 76% who died from local landslide tsunamis, like those that happened in Valdez, Seward, and Whittier. If we now look at southeast Alaska, we will see that we still have the world record of the highest wave ever recorded on Earth. It happened in 1958 in Lituya Bay in southeast Alaska, when an earthquake triggered a landslide from the glacier front. And that chunk of the mountain collapsed into the bay and generated a wave that was 524 meters, which is about 1,600 feet, which is higher than the Empire State Building. So Alaska has the world record of the highest wave ever recorded. What's interesting that slides like that have been happening in the same exact bay for centuries. And in 1936, in the same bay, there was 150 meters wave, times 3 in feet, it's going to be about 500 feet, which is the fifth largest wave ever recorded on Earth. But just recently, in 2015, there was a huge slide in Tarn Fjord, which is also in southeast Alaska, not far from Icy Bay. That landslide generated a wave of 193 meters, which is the fourth largest wave ever recorded on Earth. So Alaska has the absolute record of number one, number four, and number five waves ever recorded on Earth. But wait, we have Berry Arm. The Berry Arm slide has been recently discovered. It's a slide that's sitting up in the Berry Arm Fjord, and it's potentially very dangerous, but now we know that it's actually moving slowly because there is monitoring of that slide, and scientists are watching it, And we already did the numerical modeling to see what kind of waves it can generate in Prince William Sound and in Whittier. So this is the kind of a summary of that so-called near-field tsunami hazard in Alaska. So basically, the summary is that it's so hazardous because it's a combination of seismic active boundary and the environment of glacial fjords. So here on that photo, I am with the geologist Rob Witter from USGS in Anchorage. And we are standing in front of the wall at the Alaska Coast Guard Station in Kodiak. And that line indicates the wave height of the 1964 tsunami. During that tsunami, there were more than 10 waves that came to the Kodiak Naval Station. This is how it was called back then. And each time they got that wave, they put the mark on the wall. And this line indicates the highest wave. And this photo is the waterfront of Old Town of Valdez in 1964. And this destruction was caused by locally generated waves, the waves that were made right here in this fjord. Not the waves that came from far away, but locally generated tsunamis. The conclusion is that since we live so near to that hazard, the only way to, you know, to be alive is to get prepared, knowing what to do. Rather than waiting for officials to tell you what to do, can be actually the difference between life and death. So that little scheme shows you how we go through our program. So it's very community oriented. We start with talking to the community about the needs, what they want us to map, what kind of support they want from us. And then we generate the tsunami scenarios, which are potential earthquakes that can make the wave that could be dangerous to Valdez, for example. Then we do the modeling. Then we go to the community, present the maps, present the report, I mean, the drafts of the maps and the report, and ask for the feedback. And quite often we get really useful feedback from the community. Sometimes we miss the areas that they want us to map. Sometimes we, you know, miss the important data that they have here in the community and that we didn't have. So if needed, we go through that circle again. So now I'm going to talk about basic physics of tsunamis because it's actually important to understand how they behave, to understand how, why they are so destructive. So the tsunami is a Japanese word that has two syllables. Tsu is harbor and nami is wave. So basically tsunami means harbor wave, which is not kind of logical because why harbor wave, right? When you think about tsunamis, especially after recent videos from 2004 and 2011 disasters, you think of a tsunami as a wall of water coming to you from the ocean, right? Why harbor? This is because in Japan, hundreds of years ago, when fishermen would go in the morning to fish outside of the harbor or the fjord in the open sea on a beautiful sunny day, and they would return home from the fishing, they would see their harbors destroyed. And since when they were in the open ocean, they didn't notice the tsunami coming to the harbor because tsunami is pretty much invisible in deep water. So they thought that it was something in the bay that caused that destruction. They thought the wave was made right there and caused the destruction. That's why they called it harbor wave, because this is where they observed the effects of that wave. So, which means that if you are in deep water, you don't see it, you don't feel it. So, some useful facts about tsunamis. First of all, it's not just one wave, it's a series of waves. And the series means that it will be coming for hours. In 64, there were at least 12 hours of strong wave activity in Alaska ports and towns. Let's say in Valdez, the largest wave from the Gulf of Alaska came 11 hours after the earthquake. So tsunami waves kept coming at the interval between 20 minutes and 1 hour. And guess what? When earthquake happened on the low tide, right, the first initial waves were not as large, but 11 hours later, it was a different tide. So then that wave that happened to be on the high tide came to town and it was the largest one. Which means that now we have another lesson here. So if you evacuate in a strong tsunami, you need to stay there until it's all clear or at least for 12 hours. So who makes tsunamis? Of course, the underwater earthquakes. Then there are, of course, eruptions of volcanic islands. For example, Krakatoa. You probably remember that 1883 eruption of Krakatoa. It's a well-known story. That eruption made a tsunami that killed 33,000 people. It's one of the worst disasters on Earth. And of course, underwater landslides and subaerial landslides can generate tsunamis. So either something underwater moves down the slope, or a piece of the mountain drops into the bay and makes a tsunami. And we know now that tsunamis are not tidal waves. So tidal waves are made by gravitational forces between moon, sun, and Earth, and tsunamis are made by uplifting the water due to earthquake, for example. And finally, the very important feature of tsunamis that why they are so different from wind waves, for example. So wind waves disturb only the surface of the ocean. So let's say if this is the bottom and this is the surface of the ocean, wind waves are here. So if you dive underneath, there is quiet down there. But tsunamis behave in a way that the energy goes all the way from the surface to the bottom. So basically, a tsunami moves like that. It's like the whole thing is moving. I mean, it's hard to illustrate, but there will be an animation that shows that. So now this little sketch shows you kind of the basic structure of a tsunami when it's in the open ocean. And the title here is "The Deeper the Water, the Faster the Wave." It's like something that you need to remember to understand the future slides that are coming. So basically, the speed of tsunami in the open ocean depends on water depth. That's it. This is the only factor that tsunami speed depends on. And the distance between two crests, so let's say if we have one crest here, one crest there, and the trough here, right? The distance between two crests in the open ocean can be about 60 to 100 miles, but the wave height is about 1 foot. So now the question, can you detect something like that? No, it's impossible. So you don't notice tsunamis in the open ocean. If you are sitting on a boat, it will pass underneath you and you will not notice it. The life of a tsunami has three major stages. So first of all, tsunami needs to be made by something. It's like an underwater earthquake, eruption, landslide. The next step is tsunami propagating in the deep ocean far away from that source. And finally, the most destructive part when it hits land. This is where bad things happen. We call it inundation or run-up. So when we tell maximum inundation line, this is what happens when tsunami hits dry land and moves inland. So this animation shows you how tsunamis are made by subduction zone earthquakes. When we have one plate, let's say Pacific plate subducting underneath the North American plate, over hundreds of years, they get stuck at some point, and that amount of stress is too much to keep, and then it snaps in the earthquake, and that upward motion of the seafloor pushes the water up, and this is what makes that initial bulge on the surface, and they propagate. So let's watch this in action. So I need to move that thing. So the plates move over hundreds of years, several inches a year, and then at some point the stress is too much, it snaps, and we have that wave produced. Now it starts spreading all the way in all parts of the Pacific. So the next step is the deep ocean propagation of tsunamis. So in the deep water, tsunamis are invisible, but they travel at a speed of about 500 miles per hour, which is about the speed of Boeing 747. This is how much, about 5.5 hours it takes the tsunami to go from Alaska to Hawaii. And this is about how much time it takes us to fly from Anchorage to Honolulu, when we are lucky. So you cannot feel the tsunami in the middle of the Pacific. And I have a great story from one of the former naval officers who was in the Pacific on a Navy boat in 1957, when a huge earthquake in the Aleutian Islands made a tsunami. Back then, United States already had a tsunami warning system, and the captain got a message that there is a tsunami coming from Alaska. And he had no idea what to do. He was kind of panicking. But this guy had a geology degree. And he said, you don't need to worry. There is nothing we need to do. We will not feel it. Case is closed. So now the question is, why the wave that is invisible in the open ocean becomes so destructive when it hits the coast? So this is the photo of the Hilo Harbor in Hawaii, 5 hours after that earthquake in the Aleutian Islands, and 2,500 miles away. The amount of power is enormous. And this is because tsunami energy, as I already said before, it extends all the way from the surface of the ocean to the bottom. That's why they were capable of moving that energy all the way through the Pacific. This animation illustrates that concept. So kind of the white colors in this animation show that energy distribution from the top to the bottom. It's not easy to illustrate, but let's be imaginative. So now we have that graphics that shows why tsunamis become so destructive when they hit coastline. So what happens is that when tsunami gets into the shallow waters, first of all, they need to slow down. And you remember why? Because that slide that I said, you need to remember the title, the faster, the deeper the water, the faster the wave. This is why they slow down when they hit shallow waters. At the same time, the energy, it's still there, right? The energy that was distributed in the entire ocean depth of 3 miles, now when we get into the coastal area, right, it's just a wedge. It's shallow, but the energy is still there. So the energy doesn't disappear, we know that. So it needs to go somewhere, and that's why the wave goes up. This is basically your energy being transformed into wave height. So the wave height grows rapidly, and this is when everything happens. So this animation illustrates how tsunami inundates a generic little town in Alaska. And this is just a cartoon. We made it before we had actual footage from 2004 and 2011 tsunamis, before people had cell phones during the disasters. The previous disaster happened in 1998 in Papua New Guinea. 3,000 people died there. But of course, nobody knew about that because nobody recorded that. I mean, only scientists who went there after the tsunami to do the field survey, they could tell the story. But you know how powerful the visual stuff is, right? So this was done before that, and we tried to illustrate that most important warning sign of a tsunami when the water goes away from the shore. When you see something like that, and this is how it looks, you need to evacuate immediately, because if water goes away on a sunny day without any reason and it's not time for low tide, you need to evacuate. And this actual video from 2011 Japanese tsunami shows how it looks in real life. And you can see that tsunami, when it hits land, it's not a wave anymore. It is wave when it's in the open ocean. When it hits land, it's just an ugly sea of debris. So this is debris that involves broken houses, cars, broken glass, pieces of wood, and this is how people die. People don't die from not being able to swim in a tsunami. People die because they get wounds from all this debris. And only reinforced concrete buildings can stand during the tsunami. So all the buildings that are not concrete, they get destroyed pretty much immediately because the power is enormous. Here is the aerial view of the same front moving pretty quickly, and you can see that you cannot even drive away from it. It's very fast. So basically, evacuation is the only option if it's available. So before I go into specifics of our hazard in Valdez, I need to talk about the lessons that scientists learned from 2004 and 2011 tsunamis. In 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, 230,000 people died. The earthquake happened where the event of that magnitude was not expected, unfortunately. So scientists didn't know that an earthquake that large can happen in this particular subduction zone. So this is another subduction zone in the Indian Ocean. We have our own subduction zone in Alaska. And unfortunately, our history of recording earthquakes is extremely short. If you think about, you know, history of how long tsunamis and earthquakes have been happening on Earth, let's say it's that much, right? And the history of tsunami and earthquake recording by humans is about 100 years. So it's like, we know that much. And this is how long they have been happening. So we know little about them. But what's really disturbing is that because of that, because we were not aware of that possibility, the tsunami warning system didn't exist in Indian Ocean. Can you imagine that 7 hours after the earthquake, 300 people died in Somalia, in Africa? So the waves passed the Indian Ocean and killed people in Somalia 7 hours after the earthquake. It's very sad because in 7 hours you can evacuate anywhere. You can fly to a different continent in 7 hours. So you don't have to die 7 hours after the earthquake. Another story is the 2011 Tohoku tsunami. And this is extremely disturbing because Japan is the nation that's most prepared for tsunamis, but 20,000 people died on that day. And what went wrong here? It's a different story because Japan was prepared and we know that earthquake could happen there of that size. The only thing that was unexpected is how much uplift of the ocean floor it produced. Scientists had no idea that earthquake of that magnitude can make so much of uplift. And all the tsunami inundation maps were developed based on the assumption that the uplift could be, for example, that much. It was twice as large. That's why the tsunami maps and tsunami evacuation plans were inadequate. And people had a false sense of security. So they thought if they evacuate to the safety zone, they would be safe. They just stopped walking uphill when they reached that boundary. Finally, the lessons, at least that I learned from those disasters, is the lesson in humility. We don't know everything, and that's why there will be other surprises from the nature. I bet in the next tsunami, there will be something else that we will learn. And that's why we need to be humble and we need to be prepared. So this is the best way to get ready for the next disaster. This map, for example, shows the area that was flooded in Japanese town Manami Sanriku. And you can see that spot that's indicated by letter A. This is where they had the disaster management building. It was totally destroyed and people died there. But I mean, you can be sure that they built that disaster management building in the safety zone. So it was safe according to their plans, but they miscalculated that. Another building in the coastal area is the vertical evacuation structure. What's interesting about this slide is that white arrow is pointing at the seawall that was supposed to protect the town. But the water actually came to that third floor of that evacuation building, which is at least 3 times higher than the seawall. So this was another kind of miscalculation, but fortunately, people who evacuated on the roof of that building, they were safe. So they survived the tsunami. And this shows how important to have those vertical evacuation structures in the coastal area, because when tsunami hits and you have 15 minutes, and the high ground is so far away that there is no way to get there in 15 minutes. So this is why you need those evacuation structures. So that video shows you what happens when the seawall is not high enough. The seawall that was supposed to protect the town didn't do the job. And another goal for that video is not just, you know, to show how horrible everything is, but also to show that tsunami will keep coming. It's not just one thing like the wave coming in and then out. No, it will be coming for hours, like non-stop, continuously. That's why you need to be prepared like for a long, long time. So if we watch that video, you can see that concrete seawall, but you won't see it pretty soon. It will disappear because it will be overtopped by that wave. So it's pretty sad, but Also, it shows you how powerful it is. You just cannot escape it by driving or running, or there is no way. So the only way is to be as far away as possible from it. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about those recent earthquakes in Alaska that were, you know, of high magnitude but didn't make large tsunamis. And this is why we cannot ignore tsunami warnings. So let's talk about the magnitude 7.9 Kodiak earthquake of January 23, 2018. So this is the illustration of where it actually happened in the Gulf of Alaska. You can see the ocean bottom here and all the aftershocks of this event. And why did it make a small tsunami? To talk about that, we can talk about what's called a tsunami mechanism. There are two major mechanisms of earthquakes. One is called subduction zone earthquake or subduction type earthquake. It's when one plate goes underneath another plate and then snaps in the earthquake and the water moves up. It's called subduction. Another type of the earthquake is called strike slip. It's when the plates move parallel to each other. When the plates are moving parallel to each other, they don't produce any vertical motion. That's why the tsunami is not generated. So in this case, in the case of Kodiak earthquake, it was a strike slip mechanism. So in that earthquake, the plates moved parallel to each other. But the mechanism is not known when the tsunami warning is issued. When National Tsunami Warning Center issues a tsunami warning, they don't know if it's subduction zone or strike slip. They need only two parameters to issue the warning. And the first one is the magnitude, which is either 7 or greater. And the second is the location of the earthquake. If the earthquake is underwater and its magnitude 7 or greater, they issue the tsunami warning. They will know the mechanism, if it's strike slip or subduction zone, sometime later. But they cannot lose that time because that time is crucial. I mean, the first several minutes are important for survival. That's why they update it later when they know more. So the next example is the 8.2 Chignik earthquake that happened just recently in July of that year. So again, there was a small tsunami. And in this case, it was because the rupture or the area that actually was involved in that earthquake was pretty deep. And by deep, I mean not the sea ocean deep, but rather inside the earth. So earthquake happened at that plate that was subducting, and it was happening at the deeper part of that plate. If it happens at the shallow part of the plate, it means it happens closer to the seafloor, but this part, it was deep. But look at this example, the magnitude 8.1 earthquake in American Samoa in 2009 generated a tsunami, and 189 people died there. Think about it, the earthquake was just magnitude 8.1, and the Chignik earthquake was 8.2. In Chignik earthquake, small tsunami. American Samoa, huge tsunami, 189 people died. The difference, how deep the rupture was. It was shallow rupture in Samoa. It was close to the ocean floor. That's why it made such a big wave. But guess what? When the tsunami warning is issued, they don't know the depth of the rupture. Same thing. They need time to process that information, but at the time of the tsunami warning is not available. So basically, it's either nothing is going to happen or 200 people will die. So you cannot kind of risk that. You just follow the tsunami warning, and then if it's, you know, canceled, great, we are lucky. So these are the tsunami messages. So understanding tsunami messages is important, and there are four categories of tsunami messaging. It's information statement where no threat or very distant event, so you don't need to do anything, just for your information. There is a tsunami, I get them all the time. Let's say tsunami in the Kermadoc Tongat Range and magnitude such and such, and no threat for Alaska. Then there is a tsunami watch. It's the distant tsunami that's possible, and we are watching it, and we will let you know if you need to worry. stay tuned, basically. The message is stay tuned. Then there is advisory, which means strong currents and waves possible in your area. Stay out of water, away from beaches, away from waterways. It's advisory. And finally, the worst is warning, when dangerous coastal flooding and powerful currents possible. Move to high ground, evacuate inland. So these are the four levels of tsunami messages. So now we will talk about the history, the Great Alaska Earthquake of 1964. It is still the second largest earthquake ever recorded on Earth, and it made all kinds of waves. It made that major tsunami that was coming from the Gulf of Alaska. We call it tectonic tsunami. The tsunamis that are made by earthquakes are called tectonic tsunamis. Of course, it made a whole bunch of local landslide tsunamis in fjords and harbors, and it also made seiches. Seiche is a wave when something is tilted. For example, there is that Kenai Lake on the way to Seward from Anchorage, and if you so this is the lake, and if you tilt the bottom of the lake like that during the earthquake, the water goes to one end, and then it starts splashing like that. So it's called a seiche. So there were seiches during that event. People died in Alaska, in Oregon, and California during that tsunami. 13 people died in Crescent City. So this animation shows you how tsunami propagates in the Pacific. It's interesting to watch how different parts of the wave moves with different speed. And we know that it's determined by the ocean bottom, basically how deep or how shallow it is. You can see that tsunamis are so fast in the deeper part of the Pacific, but when they get into Bering Sea, they slow down and it becomes very slow, and people on the west coast of Alaska have lots of time to evacuate if needed. Also, the colors in this animation represent energy. And like bright colors, like red, orange, and yellow, it's like the higher energy, and other colors are lower energy. You can see that the energy beam was directed toward the west coast of the United States in this tsunami. And this is so good to know, because we can pre-compute every possible tsunami scenario, let's say along the Aleutian Islands, and see where the major beam of energy will go. And this is how we determine if this particular coastline will be safe or in danger. But as I said before, all the deaths in coastal communities like Seward, Valdez, and Whittier, they were due to local landslide tsunamis. And this is the photos of the waterfront of Alaska in March 27, 1964. This animation shows you how tsunami is made by an underwater slide. So basically, we have an unstable kind of chunk of sediment sitting on the ocean bottom, and when it shakes, it goes down, and it also sucks the water with it. So initially, there will be a depression of the sea surface, and then when you have a depression, of course, it will go up. And this is how, you know, the coastal area gets flooded. So the tsunami hazard in Valdez is the combination of tectonic tsunami hazard and landslide tsunami hazard. In 1964, there were all kinds of waves here in the harbor. And what was interesting, that engineering studies that were done after the earthquake, they concluded that slope failures did not improve the slope stability. So you would think that, you know, if something was unstable, right, and then it collapsed, then now we are all fine. No, it doesn't work that way. Unfortunately, that's why they moved the town here from original location, because the sediment that the lower river brings into the harbor, they keep depositing themselves on the steep underwater slopes, and it's still unstable. That's why this location is much better. So when we made our tsunami maps for Valdez, we considered about 20 scenarios, including both tectonic scenarios and landslide scenarios. So basically what we did, we looked at all possible earthquakes in the Gulf of Alaska that can make a wave that is bad for Valdez. And then in the Port Valdez, we looked at different locations where we can put a landslide and kind of trigger it and see what happens. So those photos show the waterfront of Old Town Valdez before and after the tsunami. What happened in the first several minutes, waterfront collapsed. and all the dogs disappeared underwater, and those slides generated the waves. If in 1964 was recorded in Port Valdez next to Shoup Bay, it was 52 meters high at the Shoup Bay. And this is the aerial photo from the airplane of Shoup Bay and Shoup Glacier, and the numbers here on the slopes indicate the wave heights that were measured. And you can see that 52 meters location, it was in Shoup Bay. So for many, many years, it was a mystery what produced that kind of wave. So just think about it. There was an earthquake in the Gulf of Alaska, strong ground shaking, and then the waves from the Gulf of Alaska came much later. They were not that high. But that initial wave was so high, and it was an enigma for many years, until in early 2000, the ship came to Port Valdez and did high-resolution bathymetric survey of the bottom, and they discovered those huge blocks sitting there on pretty much flat bottom of Port Valdez. And these blocks were identified as those that collapsed from the Shoup Glacier moraine into the Port Valdez. So those blocks, they collapsed, they moved the sediment, and that motion generated that huge wave. So mystery is solved. Now we know what was responsible for the tsunamis in Port Valdez. And this is just a kind of zoom-in view to those blocks. And you can see like something that's similar to cat eyes around the blocks. And this is that sediment that was pushed by the blocks, like bulldozer. The arrows on the arrows represent direction of tsunamis in that area. It was well documented, and the numbers show the wave height. So the final topic of this presentation is the maritime guidance, like what happens in ports and harbors, and why even the small wave can do such a great damage to the harbor. These are photos of different harbors in the United States in the 2011 Tohoku tsunami. So these two at least are Crescent City Harbor. This one is probably Japan. So you can see that very strong currents and whirlpools can happen during the tsunami. So this is an actual photo from Japan, and you can see a boat that is caught up in that whirlpool. You cannot escape that because the currents are so strong. And also there were same whirlpools observed in Crescent City Harbor, in Pillar Point Harbor, and they indicated the direction of motion of that whirlpool in the harbor. And that video shows you that even a 2 feet wave can be destructive. Why? Because you remember that tsunami energy is not at the surface, so the 2 feet wave is not just these 2 feet, it's all the way to the bottom of the channel. And in that video that was taken in Santa Cruz, California, about 12 hours after the Tohoku earthquake, it was the second wave that came to the harbor, and people unfortunately also came to the harbor to watch the waves because they interpreted tsunami warning completely differently. They were told not to go to the harbor, but they did go to the harbor. So you can see that the wave is actually rather small, but the damage it makes is not intuitive. It's kind of too much for that size of the wave. And again, you will understand that because now you know that it's not just the surface of the water that's moving, it's the entire, the power of the entire water body. So yeah, it's been pretty destructive, and people are amazed by what they see. And you can see how you can, if you just stay in the wrong place, you can die pretty much there. So what are the hazards that are specific to ports and harbors in Alaska? First of all, these are sudden water level change. When, you know, docks and boats can either hit the bottom, or they call it grounded, right? They can ground. Or on the opposite, the overtop pile says water level rises. Also, there could be very strong and unpredictable currents, just chaotic currents moving in all directions, especially, of course, where narrow entrances, narrow openings, and other narrow parts of the harbor. You know that when it's narrow, tsunami current is stronger. Of course, the eddies and whirlpools can be developed in the harbor, and the boats cannot do anything about it. You cannot control that. There is drag on deep draught boats, causing damaging forces on the docks. There could be collision between the boats, of course, and other types of damage. There is scour and sedimentation. So it's either the material is removed from the harbor because the currents are so strong, or there is material that can be brought into the harbor from another part of the bay. And important thing here is those dangerous conditions can last tens of hours. They can last real long. So it's not even 12 hours, it's more than that. The interesting topic that I never considered before that study of the port LA is the recovery delays because of environmental hazards. In Port of LA, they discovered that when they started doing that tsunami scenario exercise, they discovered there are tons of environmentally hazardous stuff sitting on the bottom of Port LA. And they didn't even know what it was there. I mean, some part they knew, some part it was just a mystery. Another thing is that in California, many houses are built with asbestos. They're old. When they get destroyed by tsunami, that stuff is exposed to everyone. So it's another hazard that can delay the recovery efforts. So where to find the maritime guidance for Valdez? If you go to our website, which is a snapshot here, it's Alaska Earthquake Center. We have a tsunami tab. Under that tab, we have maritime response guidance. If you click on that, you will get to maritime guidance for distant and local source tsunamis in Valdez Harbor. Very detailed documentation, very good instructions for people who own boats, for captains, for harbor masters. It was created after lessons learned from 2011 tsunami in California, what kind of problems people had there with boats and harbors. For example, the questions were if, when, where to move or evacuate boats, how to educate boat owners about tsunami hazards, what are the long-term recovery issues in this area, and what can be done to improve resiliency of the harbor. So the earthquakes can be two types. So it depends on if you feel shaken where you are, or if you don't feel shaken. So if you feel shaken, it means it's local, it's right here. If you don't feel shaken, it's a distant earthquake. And the result will be the same, it's going to be a tsunami, but your response is different. So same hazard, different response. Why? Because you have different amount of time, and you have different wave heights for local and distant tsunamis. So based on that, in that maritime guidance document, all the guidance kind of is split into two parts, into two sections, for distant earthquakes and for local earthquakes. So for distant earthquakes, these are the earthquakes generated in the Ring of Fire around the Pacific. And depending on what part of the Pacific they are coming from, we have between like 4 hours and maybe 12 hours before it gets to Valdez. So, for example, if there is an earthquake in the Cascadia subduction zone, which is where the west coast of the United States, then it's about 3 to 4 hours it gets to Valdez. If it's Japan, it's like more like 12 hours. So this map shows you the tsunami currents, the strength of tsunami currents in Port Valdez for distant tsunami event, like Cascadia subduction zone. It shows that the currents between 3 and 6 knots can be generated in the harbor here. And in Alaska, advice for the boat owners and captains, they should not be on their boats during a tsunami. But if they have limited options or they are very experienced and they are prepared to remain at sea for at least 24 hours, they can make an attempt to get out into deep water if they have enough time. So this is up to their judgment. Another important piece of information where they can find in that document, it's so-called the safe minimum offshore depth. So we know that deeper is better, but how deep? How far do I need to get from the shore? The recommendation is about 100 fathoms or 600 feet and at least 1/2 mile from the shore, whatever is closer. So this plot illustrates how to calculate the potential wave height and to see if the docks will overtop piles. And this combination of numbers are, first of all, the expected time of the tide at that time, how big the tide is going to be. Then potential storm surge. In some areas in Alaska, storm surges are pretty high. I guess not in Valdez, right? You don't get large storm surges here. So then the next number is the potential tsunami. And that number usually is multiplied by a factor of 1.3, which means they add 30% uncertainty. And this is the standard engineering practice to that 1.3 factor. And then when you add all these numbers together, you can see if your piles are high enough for this event. So now we are talking about local earthquake. Local earthquake is when you actually feel strong ground shaking and sometimes you can't even stand up. And this video from Japan, taken from inside the car in Japan during that earthquake, and you can see how that person decides to go downhill towards the water instead of going uphill. So this is a very disturbing video because it shows you a person who cannot actually stand up during that earthquake. So that car is running here. It gets to the intersection, and to the left is downhill to the water, and you can see that to the right is uphill. And now it starts shaking. That person, he can't stand up. He's trying to keep the balance, and everything is shaking. Guess what? He turns left. The car turns left, and he goes towards the water. And now the same person still cannot stand up. Everything is shaking. The car is moving down. But we already see that the next intersection is flooded. In the next intersection, we already have wave coming. And now this car makes the right move. It realizes that it needs to go in the opposite direction. So that car is moving, and I hope that guy who is in that car, he escaped somehow, because this car will get completely flooded at the end. And you can see how the waves are splashing into that camera inside the car. It's a rather long video. So this is the map of tsunami currents for Valdez for local scenarios. And you can see that it's a different story. So now the currents can be greater than 9 knots. And for local tsunamis, the guidance is that if you're on land or tied up at the dock, leave your boat and go immediately to higher ground. No attempt should be made to move a boat for locally generated tsunamis. So this is the difference. If for distant tsunamis, they say, okay, it's up to your judgment. If your experience, you are prepared to stay at the sea, you can try to move your boat. For local tsunamis, no way. If you're at sea, you are not supposed to return to the port until it's all clear and you need to stay in deeper water. So I want to read that statement from the harbor master in Ventura Harbor, California, after the 2011 tsunami. He said, "I understand that fishermen's families depend on the fishing boats for their livelihood, but the livelihoods depend even more on the fishermen staying alive. If I have live fishermen on shore, I want them to stay there and live." This is the conclusion. So for local tsunamis, you are not supposed to save your boat. You are supposed to be alive. So the final slide is about knowledge that pretty much equals to survival. You can experience tsunami warning signs everywhere in the world, everywhere, on every beach, and you need to know them. So if you feel strong ground shaking in the coastal area, or you see the water going away, or you see the very strange loud roar from the ocean, these are your warning signs. You need to evacuate. You don't return until all clear, or if it's pretty bad, you know that it's going to be at least for 12 hours. So you need to be prepared for that. You need to stay tuned to your radio, NOAA radio, satellite radio. You know, if communication gets cut off completely, cell towers don't work, so your only option would be NOAA radio. And you can follow the text messages from the Tsunami Warning Center. And of course, if there is no high ground, you need to evacuate vertically, which means you need to identify reinforced concrete buildings in the coastal area and move to the higher floor of that building. And if you're at sea, it's better to stay there in the deep water. So this is the new tsunami brochure that we worked together with the City of Valdez. And I'm so happy that we have that product, because now that template is being used for other coastal communities in Alaska. It has specific information on inside and the general information on the outside. And of course, another great product to use is tsunami maps on your phone. You go to tsunami.alaska.edu, you can use that interactive map portal, zoom in, zoom out, look at the inundation zone, and identify the safety areas. Another good feature here is that you can actually go to the publication link, and this is where you find the report about that community. And it's interesting to read at least about the 1964 story for Valdez in that report. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you find that presentation useful. If you need more information about tsunamis, please visit the Alaska Earthquake Center website, as well as our Facebook and Twitter pages, and the National Weather Service and National Tsunami Warning Center pages. Thank you.